Hi, and welcome back. We're talking about user requirements today. This is part of the requirements lecture by me, Abram Hindle, at the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta for the course Compute 301. If you want to email me, you can email me here, or you can go to my webpage and read about stuff there. So today we're talking about user requirements. But first, I want to show you just some requirements that exist in the wild. So, this is the HTML 5.1 specification from W3C. It's about vocabulary and associated APIs. This is more of a design document. But nonetheless, it's a very structured document. The introduction talks about background scope, audience, so they deal with the users that they're dealing with and who's reading it. Then they cover, say, like terminology. So if we go to terminology here, it talks about various terminology issues. And then you can see that they've got design level issues about, say, window objects. They've got issues about nested browsing contexts. They have they've got requirements to do with text area elements. They put these into categories. They give you a list of attributes. They give you interface. They tell you what should be done. They're saying the raw text area should be initially an empty string. These are all kind of design and requirements, all sort of mixed into one, which is understandable because this is really a document for web browser implementers, and more than one web browser implementer will read this document. Whereas SQLite has requirements like this, well specified, well named. Some requirements are even language definitions. Expression, binary operator, expression, things like that. Other ones are pretty clear. There'll be code ones, like this will invoke that. They mention methods of query flattening. There are all kinds of requirements exist through here. There's another kind of requirement, and it's the user story. These are pretty heavyweight. We're going to cover user stories in a sec, but I want to show you actual user stories. So this is from Sean Berto on GitHub, and he's got Watershed Now, which is a Drupal user manager. And so he's got user stories. So he says web admin can create, delete user accounts. Staff user can edit inline block content. Staff user can drag and drop order surveys. Staff user can add a zip code lookup field to ePetition. All this kind of stuff. You can see that there's simple lines that have a subject, usually a person, and what they can do. All right. So based on that, these complicated requirements and these slightly more simple ones, I'm going to talk about user requirements today. So, we have to identify tasks first. We want to study what tasks users do. Sometimes you can do this simply by following them around, seeing what they do at work. You have to think about what the goal of the task is and what the context of the task is. What information is needed? What are the steps that you need to complete this task? And who does the user work with? Who collaborates? And furthermore, why is the task done this way? Lots of tasks are done certain ways due to legal and regulatory regulations and specification. But a lot of tasks are done this way because they evolved that way. So they don't have a good reason why they do it that way. It just sort of changed over time. So consider forming a scenario. A scenario is basically an informal narrative. It should be personal and concrete and not particularly general. It should show this scenario should aid understanding by showing the goal, the task flow, and the possible irritants when executing that task. Here's an example scenario, and I'll read it out to you. I want to track the calories for a meal, so I consult the USDA nutrient database. I want to look up Pacific salmon, so I enter that as a keyword. Item not found, so I enter salmon and try again. That works, but I get 46 items containing salmon berries and even cloud berries. Why? I choose fish, salmon, sockeye, cook, dry heat, then figure out that I got 2.5 100 gram units for my item and scan the table to figure out that I got 422 kilocalories in the energy roll. So really, the task at hand here is figure out how much 250 grams of salmon is worth in kilocalories. That's really all they're trying to do. So that is a scenario, and from there we can identify use cases. Use cases capture the goal, capture the conditions, and the steps of a coherent interaction between an actor and the software system. It's more general than a specific scenario, and it's written from a user's point of view. So when you're defining a use case, you should identify the actor, consider the different roles a user will have, and you should define use cases, which include all the use cases. You should refine them. You should relate them. So let's go back here. Who are the actors here? Well, we've got me, or I. So we got the user. The database could be an actor. They could have called on the phone. Could have been a person. But it'll probably be an external actor that's implemented as machinery. There's no other actors here. But we can see that they have one thing where they have to query and they have to find food. And then they have to figure out the, given a food, they have to figure out the calories of a certain set amount of that food. So there's already two possible use cases there. Search for food, right? I want to look up Pacific salmon. And then there is getting the calories of a food item. So once you've got your actors identified and your use cases identified, so here we have search for nutrition info. So I want to look up. Okay. Then we have browse nutrition info. If we look here, I get 46 items. We select an item. So there's another use case, and it's related to the meal planner. So browse, and then get that information. Where did that information come from? Well, it came from the nutrient database. Perhaps we interact with the database, and we have to update nutrition info. It wasn't written in the original one, but nonetheless, if we had another actor, we'd place them here, and we'd relate them to use cases that they had. So this is a UML use case diagram. This diagram is pretty important because it explains the relationship between use cases to search, to browse, and actors, the meal planner or the administrator. What you should notice is use cases are placed in bubbles and lines are drawn to the actors they are related to. If the administrator browsed nutrition info, a line would point towards the administrator as well. What you should also notice is that the actors are represented like they were in the sequence diagram. They are represented by stick figures. Furthermore, you should notice that they interact with use cases that are inside of a square. This square is the system. You do not have a use case diagram without this square. It indicates what is internal to the system and what is external to the system. If your USDA database was external, it might be out here. Your actors are external to the system. So this is a use case diagram. These are your actors. These are use cases. They're not classes, they're not components, they're use cases. Use cases are basically tasks that you want to execute on the system. The box is the boundary of the system. Therefore, inside the box is the system itself. The lines are relations. If you want, you can generalize actors. For instance, if you have a user, the user could represent both meal planner and administrator. That might be legitimate if both of them searched and browsed. So you can use the inheritance arrow from the use case diagram, from the class diagrams, to indicate actor generalization. Okay, so we extract use cases. We figure out tasks that they want to do. Those go into bubbles. Those are the use case bubbles. Those go within the system, and then we relate the actors. This is important because it gives us a fast overview of how the actors are involved, how they're involved with the system, and what their use cases are. So here's an example of a use case. We've got search for nutrition info. The actor is the meal planner. The goal is for the meal planner to find nutrition information. The trigger is that the meal planner chooses the search option. They want to search. The precondition is the meal planner knows what they're looking for. They know the name and the amount. The postcondition is on success, nutrition info is displayed. So this is relatively simple. We got the name, we got the actors, the goal, what causes this use case to happen, what indicates we're trying to execute this use case, what we have to have before we try to execute the use case, what we expect to get after we execute the use case. Then there's flow. Flow is basically the steps of the use case. 1. The system prompts the meal planner to enter keywords. 2. Meal planner submits keywords. 3. System lists matching food, prompting for a selection. 4. Meal planner browses and selects a food item. 5. System prompts for food weight in units of 100 grams. 6. Meal planner enters food units. 7. System presents nutrition information for the amount of food. You should try to avoid saying they have a window. You should probably try avoid saying they click. You should probably try to avoid specifying any implementation specific thing, because you really want to get down what is being attempted. You want to keep it relatively general. It's understood you're dealing with software, you're dealing with some kind of computer machine, but you don't need to be too implementation specific. There can be exception cases, and you can add them to the basic flow. And you can, instead of being in the basic flow, you can put them out into exceptional cases. So the system lists matching food, prompting for a selection. What if nothing matches? So 3, there are no matching foods. 3.1, system displays an error. 3.2, system returns a step 1. So it returns to the prompt. 7. If food units is non-numeric, use 0 and proceed. So if they enter in something wrong, just enter in 0 and proceed along. So, other aspects of a use case are qualities. For instance, if we wanted to care about the latency or performance, we could list them in qualities. We could have constraints. We could say that we rely solely on one data set. We could include use cases. We could extend use cases. We could relate other artifacts. Artifacts mean things like source code, requirements, use cases, documentation, external specification. We could write notes, and we could attach issues to this, or describe things that haven't been actually dealt with. So you can include use cases. Imagine they had the login to the system. You might include the login use case. Imagine you already had browse. Perhaps this use case extends the browse use case. Then you wouldn't have to rewrite a lot of the basic flow if you already had the browse use case. So, the essential use case. Search for nutrition info. A good name for the use case. You give it a good name. The user intention of a meal planner is basically to initiate the search. And then the system responsibility is to request keywords. They submit the keywords. The system responsibility is to list the matching foods. They select the food. They request food units. They enter food units. And they present nutrition information. That's basically how the flow works. You could put this in a sequence diagram if you wanted. Now, what I want you to do is I want you to think about the use case. I want you to think about the qualities, the constraints, the exceptions, the basic flow, the name, the actors, the goals, the triggers, the preconditions, and postconditions. And I want you to consider what is the basic flow for withdrawing cash from a bank machine. So, stop the tape right now and take out some paper and start writing up a use case for withdrawing cash from a bank machine. Remember, we want the basic flow, we want exceptions, we want a good name. Okay, so I'll count down from 10. You can stop the video. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, and we're back. So what did your cash machine look like? Did you have anything about insufficient funds? Did you have anything about login or password? Did you include a login? Or did you specify the whole login stage? Did you specify you go back to a menu? So consider that. We can relate use cases. Use cases can include or use other ones. We can use the stereotype and we can use the broken dashed line and an arrow to imply that our use cases include things. And we can use this in our use case diagram. So pay bills online and get balance online, which could have been related to your bank machine, could include the login. The login might be extended by, say, a reset password use case. So the reset password is a different use case where you've forgotten your password, you want it to be reset, and extends the login case. Sometimes you might make a generalization. Maybe make deposit and make withdrawal are pretty similar to do ATM transaction. And maybe do ATM transaction covers that logging in. All right? So we just covered use cases and use case diagrams. Use cases are great to describe tasks and to figure out what the system should do. Use cases are good when you're designing things and designing mockups. You can reference the use case and mention how they fulfill the tasks in the use case. Remember that use cases have qualities, constraints, exceptions, flows, names, actors, goals, and they involve actors. And your use case diagram is basically a box with a bunch of use cases and bubbles linked to actors who are represented as stick figures. So, that's how use cases work. So now let's get into user stories. You remember that I brought up user stories earlier. User stories here are simple sentences that say what the system can do. The web admin can manage primary and secondary links. The web admin can choose between the color palette options for all three of the child themes. So, the old and still common method was that we would specify our needs by writing down all the requirements. The users would only get what was written. Agile methods are a little different. They involve less writing and more talking. I want to show you what I mean by writing. Look at this. This is a lot of text, right? Like, this is just one part. There's other draft forms and there's other things. Like, if I go to common infrastructure, this one's really big too. You know, tons of text. And look, there's even these things here that say, oh, watch out, you could track a user with them. There's all these cross-cutting concerns, there's lots of text, it's a lot of work. Look at these requirements. They're pretty short, but there's still a lot of work. There's lots and lots of requirements there. Like, the soft limit leap is soft because SQLite strives to stay below the limit, things like that. So there's all these kinds of requirements. And they're a lot of work to write. So, let's go back. With Agile, we want to do less writing, more talking. And we want users to get what they want rather than just writing it down. And we can get users what they want by talking with them. The user story is a way where we can communicate clearly with the user, and we can get their requirements sort of quickly, and we can get a written description of what they want to achieve from a system. So the user story here is, as a guest, I want to reserve a hotel room. As a guest, I want to see a list of room amenities. As a conference planner, I want to see meeting room capacities. Now start thinking about generalization. How are these sentences similar? Well, they're small, they're on index cards, they have typical forms. As a user role, I want a role. As a user role, I want goals so that reason is satisfied. So we specify user stories that way. And I showed you before that user stories are indeed specified that way. We can see here that the user stories follow this same kind of pattern. Staff user can create a survey via the web form module. Staff user can set the max registration number. So, those are user stories, but how do we make them? Well, first off, we want to describe what and not how. We want to avoid technical details and technology choice, unless it is a development constraint. It might be a real requirement. Furthermore, avoid really long stories. It's better to take a huge story and split up in the smaller stories. Think about that big scenario we went through. That is an inappropriate user story, but it has smaller user stories inside of it. We could say, as a meal planner, I want to search for food. As a meal planner, I want to browse possible foods. As a meal planner, I want to get the calories for a set weight of food. Those would be legitimate user stories based on that. Furthermore, you want to prioritize user stories. Some user stories aren't as worthwhile as others. If you had the user story, as a meal planner, I would like to get a report of everything that I looked at, perhaps that's a lower priority than actually looking up the foods they were looking for. So you should also discuss with the user to find out what they value and stage the development based on that first. So if they can help you prioritize, then use their hints. Furthermore, when you define a user story, you can suggest an effort estimate that it takes to complete. If a user story takes more than a couple of days, then maybe you should consider breaking it up into more user stories such that they take smaller times. If things take weeks, you won't do them. You don't want to spend weeks on a user story. You want to have it broken down into smaller user stories. You can use these stories to basically plan your development tasks. You can say, in this iteration, we are addressing these user stories. What are good user stories or work items? Well, one thing you can rely upon is SMART. So you want your user story to be specific, you want your work items and user stories to be measurable, achievable, relevant, and time-boxed. Specific means you specify appropriately. It isn't completely general, it's actually achievable. Then you want it to be measurable. You want to know if you can achieve it by measuring. If you can measure it, then you can know if it is achievable or if you have achieved it. If something is achievable or not, it might not be a matter of you achieving it, it might be a matter of it being realistic. Furthermore, good work items should be relevant. Furthermore, they should be small enough that they're time-boxed. They shouldn't be taking weeks, it should be very small, it should be hours. Even if it's in like 72 hours or more. So consider investing in good user stories. INVEST stands for independent, negotiable, valuable, estimatable, small, testable. Independent means when you can implement one user story at a time. They're not completely dependent on each other. Now there's going to be dependencies sometimes, but a good user story is relatively independent and you can pick it up anytime. A user story should be negotiable. You should be able to negotiate with a user whether or not it's necessary and also understand its priority. Furthermore, it should have a priority. It should be valuable in a certain sense. The user should actually want it implemented. Furthermore, you should be able to estimate that story. If you can't estimate the story, it implies that there's probably a bunch of work that you need to hash out and a bunch of sub-stories you need to make. This means you should make it smaller. A small user story is an achievable user story, and a small user story lends itself to be a testable user story that you can actually write tests for to know if you achieved that user story. So here, consider testable user stories. As a meal planner, I want to see information for a given food, for a given amount of a given food. What could we test? How could we test this? Well, we could try some acceptance tests. We could say, try it for 250 grams of baked Pacific salmon. We could try it with a missing food name. We could try it with a non-numeric amount. If it passed for the first one, and and it didn't provide anything for the second two, then it would probably be okay. We can provide this on the back of a card. So we're back to cards again, back to using paper. Paper is malleable, paper is easy, you can stick it on the wall. You can also annotate them. You can also use an issue tracker. Alright, so we were talking about user stories. User stories are valuable because they are short and concise ways of describing what we want done in a system. User stories are, as a guest, I want to reserve a hotel room. User stories, in reality, look much the same. Web admin can edit PayPal settings. See, that's a reasonable user story. We also talked about use cases. We talked about how use cases can generalize, can be extended, can include. We talked about how use cases are built from a name, the actors, goals, triggers, basic flow. We also discussed use case diagrams, how the boundaries implies the system and the bubbles imply the use cases and the actors are outside the box. Right? So we discovered those. And we talked about how user stories should be smart and we should invest in good user stories. We should also make sure that they're testable. Okay? Thank you for your time. We'll carry on in another lecture about augmenting requirements. Thank you.